OSCAL asked me if I would like to review their PAD 90. This is an Android tablet that can turn itself into a PC. That seemed interesting enough to say yes. Full disclosure, they sent this one to me free of charge and I do get to keep it. All opinions on my own though, and I'll try to stick to the facts as much as possible. Right, let's unbox it. The box has a premium feel over it and slides open in a very satisfying way. Oops. The first thing we're greeted with is this screen protector. I'll leave this off at first, but I will put it on later. Next is the PAD 90 itself, in what seems to be a protective case. Yep, just the case. So shiny! Underneath is this USB A to C cable. A 10 watt USB charger. Some literature. And a tool to eject the SIM card and the SD card slot. Nothing underneath, right? Nope. The tablet has a power button, volume controls and a microphone hole on the right hand side. A USB-C slot and a SIM card and SD card slot at the top center. And a headphone jack at the top right. And two speakers facing left, or bottom when you use it in landscape mode. Some specs. It has an almost 11-inch IPS display with a 1280x800 resolution, a 7700mAh battery, a Unisoc T606 8-core max CPU at 1.6 GHz, 8GB of RAM and 128GB of internal storage, an 8MP front camera and a 13MP rear camera, and the OS is DocOSP 4.0, which is based on Android 14. It has Widefine L1 support. I had to look that up, but basically that's some sort of DRM used by services like Disney Plus and Netflix. Level 3 is pure software and limited to 480p. Level 2 is done on a chip, but still limited to 540p. And level 1, which this tablet has, should unlock the highest quality. Now, since this device only has a 1280x800 resolution screen, that means you will be limited to 720p, but only because of the screen resolution. Right, I'm going to play with it for a while, back in 8 seconds. Oof, those were long seconds. So, first thing I'd like to mention is the screen. Its 1280x800 resolution is low, especially given the screen size and the fact that you usually keep it way within arm's reach. Apart from that, it's a very nice screen that goes pretty bright. Something that kinda bothered me was the sound. It's loud! It sounds fine, but even at its lowest settings, you aren't going to watch a YouTube video next to a sleeping baby. It's a bit hard to capture on camera, but this is how loud my sound level meter perceives the lowest volume. Compare that to the lowest volume of my phone, for instance. I feel the lowest setting before going completely silent is way too loud on this tablet. Might not be a huge issue for you, but I thought I'd address that. Right, let's look into PC mode. It doesn't seem to have any video out capabilities, so you're limited to the built-in screen with its 1280x800 resolution. I tried several USB-C to HDMI converter cables and none worked. I tried connecting it to my USB-C dock and as you can see here, the external display stays off. I can utilize my keyboard and mouse though. The PC mode turns the interface into a Chrome OS-like environment, with a menu bar and a button to find your apps. It also adds window decorations to apps, so you can manage them more easily like desktop applications. This of course does cost you some screen real estate, which at this resolution can be a bit much for some apps. Like here where I'm trying to play the game on my website. It cuts off the top or bottom of the image. I couldn't find a way to make the page show full screen, or to remove the window decorations for an app, or hide the menu bar. It really depends on the app you plan to use though. Google Meet for instance is fine, perfectly usable to join a meeting. The PAD 90 comes with WPS Office pre-installed, which also works fine in this layout. Great for writing, or calculating. The YouTube app is clearly not made for this mode. It works, but it's not ideal. I guess PC mode wasn't made with this in mind though, and for productivity tools it's quite nice. By the way, you can easily get out of PC mode by clicking here and then click the PC mode icon. It gives you a warning that all apps started in this mode will be closed, and after that you're back to a basic Android layout. You can still use the keyboard and mouse in this mode, it's just not as convenient, as this layout really is made for touch navigation. Interestingly, the game on my side just gets rendered bigger, so you still have the issue of some cut parts. I guess portrait mode is better for these kind of things. I think it's more likely that you're gonna use a Bluetooth keyboard and mouse with a system like this one, so let's try that. They do sell a variant with a keyboard and mouse included, but mine came without it, so I don't have a chance to test that for you. Anyway, connecting went flawlessly, and it works just as well as the USB connected set I used before. I can SSH into my test box without issues, so if you're an IT guy on the road, this might be useful for you as well. Just like on a normal desktop, you can drag the edges of an app to change its size, or use the buttons on the window decoration to maximize or minimize it. Now that I have my USB port free for other things, let's test some external storage. See if it can handle the amazing speed of my ZIKE drive, which is a USB 4 NVMe enclosure I showed in an earlier video. Well, it can be used, but it's not very fast compared to connecting it to a Thunderbolt 4 or even a USB 3.0 port. Given it also doesn't support a secondary screen via USB-C, I think this is only a USB 2.0 port. I found that under settings you can choose to enter or leave PC mode when a keyboard is connected or disconnected. Let's try that. Turn my keyboard off. Exit. Yes, please. Turn it on again. Let's check the don't ask thingy. Works like a charm. So what more can we do with it? Android game seems to run fine. Here's Disney Speedstorm. And Sonic Dash runs great as well. I'm wondering if it's suitable for some emulation. I figured anything from the pre-3D generation should run fine, so I started with Nintendo 64, using the M64 Plus FC emulator. Mrs. Pac-Man plays fine at 960x720. Anything higher is not a great experience. The same can be said for Mario Kart 64. For PlayStation 1, I installed the Duck Station emulator. Road Rash 3D runs fine upscaled to 720p. Any higher wouldn't make any sense on this screen. And the same can be said for Crash Bandicoot Warped. For PlayStation Portable, I installed PPSSPP. Flat Out Head-On is fine on 2x resolution. 3x and/or anti-aliasing makes it stutter a lot. The same can be said for Assassin's Creed. For Dreamcast, I installed Flycast. Crazy Taxi 2 is only fine on native resolution. Setting it to widescreen is no problem, but that's the limit. Sonic Adventure 2 is the same. Even enabling frame skip does not allow me to push it any further. By the way, I muted this one because I couldn't find a way to turn off the in-game music, and I don't need a copyright claim for using that. For GameCube games, I installed the Dolphin emulator. TMNT is fine on native resolution. Higher is not an option. The same can be said for Super Monkey Ball 2. Although there were some stutters and cutscenes, the game is fine. The Dolphin emulator can emulate Wii games as well. Both Super Mario and Mario Kart were pretty much unplayable though. For PlayStation 2, I installed the PPSS22 emulator, which was the first emulator to show ads in the free version. Yeah. Disney Pixar Cards is totally unplayable. DreamWorks Madagascar is almost playable. So I guess the limit of emulation on this device can be set at Dreamcast and GameCube games. Enabling performance mode didn't seem to make any difference in any of the games I tried. But what about DOS games? For this I installed Magic DOS Box. About any DOS game I throw at it runs fine. Strangely, my Bluetooth mouse doesn't work here. I need to use the touchscreen to use the mouse. Pretty sure this is a magic dustbox issue though, and doesn't have anything to do with the Pad 90 itself. So, what else do we have? Well, the cameras are okay. Here's a picture of the box, taken with a 13 megapixel rear camera. Here's my empty cup. And this is a pic of yours truly, taken with the 8 megapixel front camera. It's decent enough, but nothing to write home about. Let's try that screen protector. Yeah, works fine. Just as responsive as without. Looks good. Not a whole lot to tell you about it really. Oh, I almost forget to test it on a mobile network. Let's take out the tray. Oh, it has to go in the other way around or else my SIM card will fall out. We are connected! Let's disable Wi-Fi. Wi-Fi will turn on automatically. Don't turn back on. Right, let's try a website I haven't visited yet. Microsoft.com. Yeah, works. 4G enabled, so at least here in Europe it should work fine. Now give me back my SIM card, I need that to be in my phone. So what's the verdict? It feels like a rigidly built device. The included cover is a nice touch. This cover does not lock or awaken the device, by the way, so make sure to turn the screen off before you close it. The screen looks quite nice, but its 1280 by 800 resolution is not great for a screen of this size. For the price, it's a nice machine though, with some interesting features. The PC mode is a nice touch for instance, and it's capable enough for some light gaming. The ability to add one or even two SIM cards will make it a great travel companion as well. That's all I have for you today. If you feel I haven't covered something you'd like to know about this device, please tell me in the comments. There's a link to the Pad 90 in the description and the pinned comment below, in case you'd like to check it out for yourself. Thank you very much for watching. Until next time.